This is a false accusations and false convictions class, and you probably, for those of you who've heard about multiple personality disorder, which is today called dissociative identity disorder, you might not have ever thought of those two subjects, false convictions and multiple personality, a type of mental illness, together. But I hope you'll understand when I finish the lecture, by the time I finish, why this diagnosis created a lot of havoc in the culture and actually led to this problem that you're studying. As Dr. Horowitz said, I'm a journalist and originally was writing in the 80s about false accusations, primarily in daycare centers around the satanic ritual abuse panic. And as I tell the story about how I got interested in the book that I just wrote, Sybil Exposed, you'll see why I got interested in it. How many of you remember the book Sybil? This was the cover. Okay, I'm so glad that we have seniors here today because this was a book in the 70s, in the 1970s, and it was an incredibly popular book. It sold 6 million copies within just a few years, came out in 1973. That's a lot of books. Emily, next. You need to stay here. Okay. And right after, then it was made into a TV movie in 1976. It showed on two nights in November 76. One fifth of the American population watched this movie. It had an incredible impact on the culture. That's essentially the story. A little girl has a psychotic mother. The mother rapes her when she's very small. She develops a lot of personalities, different selves inside her head, to sort of encapsulate the trauma. She doesn't know, her own self doesn't have any memory of this, but she develops all these different personalities to sort of put a package around that trauma. And then she spends years in therapy, and this is actually the very end of the book and the end of the movie, when she finally remembers, and the fact that she remembers causes her to be able to deal with the trauma, and all of the personalities come together and she's one person again. And that is the story of Sybil. And as you can see, it's an incredibly dramatic story. And if you can imagine, this was on television. The scenes that you saw were on television in 1976. It was unprecedented to have these kinds of depictions of sexual violence, and it was incredibly popular. So we're going to look at why it was so popular and what the results of that, what did that do in our culture. Okay, so this is my book, which came out in October, and I found out that the woman who was Sybil never had multiple personalities as a child. Her mother was not psychotic. There's no evidence that her mother ever performed this abuse on her. And yet, this book, Sybil, and the movie Sybil, the TV movie, actually got the diagnosis multiple personality disorder into the DSM, and I'll explain to you what that is later. It actually got it into the field of psychiatry. Come over here, Emily. Okay. Who was Sybil? Here she is. Her name was Shirley Mason. She was born in a little town in southern Minnesota in 1923, and here she is in about 1927. Go ahead. Here is her mother. Do you see the woman in the middle, on the bottom, this thin woman here? That's her mother. Now, if you noticed in the film, she looked like a potato, right? She looked kind of overweight and kind of crazy looking. This is actually Mrs. Mason. And then over to the bottom left is Shirley Mason, the little girl. This is when she's about 10 years old. Again, my research was based on a whole lot of archival material, mainly at John Jay College. The papers of the journalist who wrote the book didn't indicate that there was anything wrong with her when she was this age. The mother actually was often depressed, but there's no evidence that she was psychotic. Okay?
You just push enter when you want to.
No, you do it. The family was, does anybody know what Seventh-day Adventism is? The family was in a little town and they were Seventh-day Adventists, and which means, this is from a revival from that period in the Midwest. Her family could very well have been at something like this. You can see it's a very rural type of atmosphere. They believed very strongly in the Second Coming. They believed it was going to happen any minute. I mean, literally any minute the world could end and everybody had to be ready. One thing that they had to do was celebrate the Sabbath on Saturday, the way Jews do, and they also had dietary restrictions, very strict dietary restrictions. And so she lived in a town where there weren't too many Seventh-day Adventists, and this kind of isolated her, the practices of this religion isolated her. And I think that was one of the reasons that she was kind of a troubled child. She was sort of a loner. This religion would not allow any kind of fiction writing, fiction reading. You couldn't read any fiction. You couldn't go to the movies because that would distract you from thinking about when the world was going to end. So that was sinful. She was a very imaginative child. She was into art and she loved to write fiction, but she had to sneak it. She had to do it secretly, which made her feel very guilty. So she was a child with problems. Emily? Okay. This is her report card when she's in about, you know, maybe fifth grade. And you can see she's not the greatest student. She's not terrible, but she's not great. You see the B's and the C's and stuff and the D's. I mentioned this because in the book, Sybil, it said she was a straight-A student until her personalities would take over. So you can see that she wasn't a straight-A student. Here's a picture of her when she enrolled in college. She went to a secular school, which was unusual for people in this religion. And she was very serious about art. She went to art school. Okay, Emily? Mm-hmm. Here she is in her art class in college. Okay, next. She was having problems when she was in art school. She was having fainting. She would faint in class. Nobody knew why. She would have hyperventilation. She was, you know, losing control of herself in college, and her professors and fellow students were starting to worry about her. And she went to a doctor. She was taken to the Mayo Clinic, actually, and she was diagnosed as a hysteric, which is a diagnosis that doesn't exist today, but it has a very old, old history. And the original idea of hysteria was that your womb, it was a sickness of women. The womb was wandering around in your body, and it was creating all of these emotional upsets. And the solution for hysteria was to get married, because that was sort of, you know, intercourse would fix the womb in one place. So you should get married and have kids and have lots of sex and children, and that will make you calm down. And this actually survived. These ideas survived up into the early 20th century. What you're looking at here is 19th century depictions of hysteria from France. And this was kind of the home of hysteria in the late 19th century. And these women are in a mental hospital called the Salpêtrière. And there was a doctor there named Charcot who had this idea that when you were hysterical, not only might you have something like paralyzed limbs, or you might just fall down and not be able to walk, or you might have blindness for no organic reason, or you might have deafness. But you would also have these hysterical attacks, and you would do these weird things with your body. Well, this doctor showed the patients, you know, these pictures, and then the patients would have these attacks. So, you know, once he died, they stopped having all of these behaviors. So people started wondering if maybe hysterics were kind of enacting what was expected of them. Okay, next picture. This is Cornelia Wilbur, who would later become the therapist of Sybil, Shirley Mason. She was born in 1908, and she came from a family of scientists. Her grandfather was a scientist, her father was a scientist, he's a chemist, and an inventor. And she actually went to college earlier to be a chemist, and then told her father she wanted to go to med school. And he said, "You're too stupid to go to med school." And she went to med school anyway by sort of wheeling and dealing. She married a guy who was a little younger than her, who was a dentist, who could support her, and she divorced him as soon as she finished medical school. And she always was kind of looking out for the next new thing. She was very invention-minded because of her family background. Here's something that she got involved with in the early 40s. She was giving shock treatment to patients. This was pretty controversial even in the 40s. Notice that she doesn't sign her name Cornelia Wilbur, she signs it C.B. Wilbur, because there was a lot of prejudice against women doctors. So she's also, Emily? She's involved with lobotomies. She's one of the first doctors to give lobotomies to people in the 1940s, which destroyed a lot of people's brains. It's just, you know, later on was determined to be very, very abusive and very unethical. It's not done anymore. Again, you see her trying to, C.B. Wilbur probably trying to appear to be a man. Okay, Emily. Now, she had a mentor in college. His name was Dr. Robert Dieterle. And Dr. Dieterle was a psychiatrist at her school, her med school, and she was very close to him. He was very interested in hysteria, and he started doing these experiments in the 1930s to try to create his weird sort of behaviors in hysterical teenage girls. And well, I'm going to show you a movie right now. You can see some of the stuff that he did. He would give young women baby bottles. No, it's this one. Yeah. He would give young women at the hospital who were on the hysteria wing, he would give them baby bottles filled with warm milk. And they would revert. They would start acting like babies. And if we can get this thing rolling, I'll show you this. This is her mentor.
Okay, just gonna take 1 second.
Okay. Okay, good. So we'll just do a little bit of this, not the whole thing.
Okay.
I actually found this in a barn. The son of Dr. Dieterle had this in a barn in Michigan. And this was shown at a national conference of the APA, the American Psychiatric Association, in 1936. Did you notice that arch that she did?
Mm-hmm.
He was very much into that arch from the 19th century. All right, so he's got these two girls in bed, he's giving them bottles, and they're starting to sort of act like babies, which if you were a hysterical girl and you had a doctor give you a baby bottle and you were trying to please the doctor, there's a good chance you would do this. They're sucking their thumbs. They're talking baby talk. I think the doctor doesn't like that. This guy, you're going to see some very odd behavior. Have you ever heard of a doctor like doing this like a baby? Playing baby on the bed? He's also going to do, look at what he did there. He could, you know, today I think he would be prosecuted for molestation. So everybody's having a great time here. I don't want to show you the whole thing because we don't have time, but no one really knows what happened to these girls, although I did see in some literature that one of them committed suicide later on, much later. It doesn't seem like this kind of therapy did them much good. Okay, you see, this is from the 1936 article. He published this in a journal, and you see he has his girls doing the arch, which is a pretty good indication that he probably had a coffee table book of the French stuff, which actually was in a coffee table book. So you can see there's sort of a performative thing. There's this thing with people who've been diagnosed as hysterics wanting to do things that they believe that the doctor wants them to do. Okay. Now, Dr. Dieterle was very interested in a book called The Dissociation of a Personality, which was a book from the early 20th century that everybody read in the United States who was interested in this phenomenon of having lots of different personalities. And he probably recommended this book to Dr. Wilbur. And she saw Shirley Mason because of this hysterical problem she was having with the fainting and so on. She saw her in the 40s when she was kicked out of school, and she started telling her things that she was interested in. They kind of got to be friends, which is a little odd. You know, she saw her 5 times in Omaha, Nebraska, and she told her about this book, The Dissociation of Her Personality. So Shirley Mason, the woman who would later become Sybil, when she was 22 years old, was reading this book. In other words, it was almost like she had a manual to learn how to do it. Okay, Emily. Dr. Wilbur, during World War II, also got very interested in shell shock. This was a big problem during World War II. Soldiers were going to the front. They were coming back with hysterical blindness, with hysterical deafness, unable to walk, the same things that had always been thought of as just a woman's problem. Now men were coming back and acting the same way. So that was a big problem. Hundreds of thousands of soldiers were coming off the battlefield like women hysterics. So what do you do about them? Well, Emily, one thing that was done that seemed to be very effective was to inject them with barbiturates in the vein. And while they were basically drunk, because that's what barbiturates do, they just get you acting very, very drunk, the psychiatrist would say, you don't have to be deaf, or you don't have to be crippled. You can stand up and walk. They would give them suggestions, in other words. And this was often very helpful. They would also tell the soldiers to remember the terrible things that had happened to them while they were under the influence of these drugs. Sometimes the soldiers couldn't remember anything. And so often the doctors would actually make up scenarios, battlefield scenarios, for them to reenact, and that seemed to help them for some reason. So Dr. Wilbur started giving these drugs to civilians who were, to civilian hysterics, to women who had the problems that I've mentioned before. And she was a pioneer in that. Here's Shirley Mason in 1952. She's a teacher in Michigan. She's doing pretty well. She's got a whole lot of kids. She's teaching fourth graders, and she's doing pretty well, but she sometimes has problems. You can see she's very thin. She's often suffering from anorexia, particularly she suffers from anxiety periodically, and she gets anorexic. She suffers from sleeplessness, and to me it looks like here that she's probably going through one of these periods. She's very, very thin, but at the same time she's teaching. She's got a job. She's very functional in that regard. She decides she wants to go to New York and study. She wants to get a master's in art education at Columbia University. All of her friends in Minnesota are doing that. So she decides that's what she wants to do. And here she is as an artist again, okay? She comes to New York City. This is what it looked like back then, 1954, okay? And Dr. Wilbur, meanwhile, has become a psychoanalyst. And I put this in here just so that you would see that psychoanalysis was so popular during this period that there were comic books about it. And Dr. Wilbur is a psychoanalyst, okay? And Shirley goes to see her, and she goes for a few weeks and just has sort of normal therapy. But Dr. Wilbur's busy. I mean, she's living in Manhattan, and she actually has a practice on Park Avenue, and she's got a lot of patients, and Shirley feels very needy. She feels like she wants more attention. One day, she knocks on Dr. Wilbur's door. Dr. Wilbur answers the door, and she seems like a little girl. She's not dressed as carefully, and she's talking like a little girl. She says, "Hi, I'm Peggy." And Dr. Wilbur says, "Oh, wow, she's pretty fascinated by this. Oh, she seems to be multiple personality." And immediately, they sort of get into this multiple personality diagnosis. And this is something now, again, there's all these documents over at John Jay College. Here's one where Shirley asks Dr. Wilbur if she can read things. Can I learn about it? Is it okay if I read about multiple personality? Yeah, you can read about it, she says. You can. She told her to go to the New York Academy of Medicine and she could read more about it, okay? So again, she's being told to learn about it, and this is one of the books she reads again. This is the second time she reads the book. Okay? Dr. Wilbur starts giving her all kinds of drugs, which are becoming very popular in the 50s, mass marketed to women, to housewives. It's very interesting to look at these ads. This is a downer. Serpacil is a downer. And you can see here that it's being given to housewives who are, I mean, that's sort of the advertising motif. It's the frustrated housewife. Okay, I got a couple more of these too. This one is another, this is a tranquilizer. So here's another hassled housewife. Okay, next. This one is an upper. This is Speed, Dexamil. Well, what will it do? Well, you know, you can vacuum better. Okay, and here's another one. Next. Not only, sometimes they have uppers and downers in the same drug. This is Thorazine and Dexamil. So, and you can see the woman there who sort of looks like the Madonna, which I think is interesting. Okay, so Shirley was getting all of these drugs, she's getting massive amounts of drugs, and not just drugs. And this is so that she will remember her trauma. Remember, because something terrible must have happened to her. That's the theory in multiple personality. Something terrible happened to you, and it sort of, you know, causes you to create these personalities. And by now, by a few months after her first diagnosis, she has 5 different personalities, including a little boy. So what is the problem? Well, we've got to get to the bottom of it. How do we do that? Well, we take all these drugs. Okay, one more. Next. Also, electroshock. Dr. Wilbur, who, as we saw earlier, was experimenting with electroshock in the 40s, still has this little portable unit, and she brings it over to Shirley's house, and she gives her electroshock on top of all the drugs. She also gives her pentothal, another drug which is left over from World War II. That's the drug that was being used to help the soldiers. Well, there's an idea about pentothal that you can't lie when you're injected with pentothal. Everything you say will be true. That's actually not the case. It's been discovered since then that you can easily fantasize like crazy when you're under pentothal. But you see here, this is a Lois Lane comic book, and she's basically saying a hypnotic drug that forces a patient to tell the truth. So she's got all these schemes about how she's going to get Superman to do some stuff. So, but this is how popular this idea is. Okay. Shirley starts to spout all kinds of material, like the kind of stuff that you saw in the movie. Dr. Wilbur says, did your mother do something wrong to you? Did your mother do something bad? Well, Dr. Wilbur is also becoming very close to Shirley and wants to be like a mother figure to her. She's like giving her clothes, she's giving her furniture, she's paying her rent, she's giving her odd jobs to do, and she doesn't like the mom, and she makes it clear to Shirley that she doesn't like the mom, and she gives her the pentothal in the vein, and Shirley starts telling all these terrible stories, like the ones that you saw there. And everyone thinks that they're true because you can't lie under pentothal. She becomes addicted, as a matter of fact. I idolize and idealize you. I think whatever you say must, of course, be right. So you see, this is almost like a love letter that she's writing to her therapist, that anything that her therapist tells her, she'll do. Okay. Now, they continue this therapy for several years, and finally, Shirley's a lot better. She has those scenes like what you saw in the movie. And then the two of them decide that they want somebody to write a book. They've been planning on writing a book for a really long time, but Dr. Wilbur wasn't a good writer. So they found a journalist, and this is a picture of her in the 40s, when she was a young woman having a lot of problems with prejudice against women. Her name is Flora Shriver. She's from New York. Okay. She gets together with the two, with Shirley Mason, and with Dr. Wilbur, and they come up with a pseudonym, which is Sybil for the patient, and they start writing this book. And this is something from the archive again, and they're talking about how to write this book in such a way that it will be a bestseller. And the writer, Flora Shriver, says, from a reader's point of view, it would certainly be more interesting if these personalities are women than if they're children. All the personalities were children. But they realized that wasn't very sexy, that readers don't want to read a big, long, scary book just about children. They want it to be about adults. And so they did change most of the personalities to adults. But they did many, many changes like this. It's basically a fictional book. Okay. And the book came out, and it was a huge success, as we said. And, you know, this is Dr. Wilbur vetting the book with some professors. Okay. And here's the movie again. Maybe I can do this. Yeah. And this is Flora Shriver as she becomes very well-to-do, and she's getting her hair done, and she's very famous. This is what she looked like when she became a celebrity. It was very important for Sybil's identity to be kept secret because so much in the book was fiction. And if people knew who she really was, that she was Shirley Mason from a little town, Dodge Center, Minnesota, well, they knew that her mother wasn't psychotic, and they knew that she hadn't exhibited any multiple personality behaviors as a child. So it was very important to keep her identity a secret, and that became difficult because people in Minnesota knew that it was her. The book didn't disguise her very well. So she had to go into hiding, and she basically was in hiding from 1973 until her death in 1998. She basically moved in with Dr. Wilbur. Dr. Wilbur had moved to Kentucky to take a professor job at a university, and Shirley moved there and lived with her for the rest of their lives. Now, why did we believe the story? That was the question that I asked myself as I wrote the book. And as I looked at the archive, at John Jay, and I saw dozens and dozens of letters that people wrote to the writer, to Flora Shriver, young women primarily. And they wrote about how, for one thing, they were so disturbed at all the abuse that takes place in families. This was a period when we were first starting to really acknowledge abuse inside families, physical abuse, sexual abuse. It became a public issue. And you know, women during that time were really starting to make a public issue out of all the violence that was done to women and little girls. And the other thing was happening, of course, was the women's movement. And of course, all of the older people here will remember how heady that was for women, how exciting it was. There was this idea all of a sudden that all the ceilings are breaking and you can do what you want. You know, all of a sudden, you can maybe have a man's job. You can have sex before marriage, you know, and it won't ruin your life. You can use birth control. You can do all of these things that you never, that were never allowed. But at the same time, there's still all this terrible pressure on you to be a good girl. If you're married and you do get a job outside the house, you still have to come home and do all the dishes and do the cooking and change the diapers because the husbands still aren't doing it. So there's all kinds of conflicts. There's a feeling of great possibility, and there's a feeling of conflict and fear and that you're overwhelmed. You're overwhelmed with these new roles at work and your sexual roles and your domestic roles and your roles as a daughter, and your parents still have certain expectations. And a lot of people wrote to Flora Shriver telling her that the idea of multiple personality really was helpful for them, even if they didn't take it literally. You know, they could still feel what it was like to be split. The idea of being split for women was very compelling. Is it inter? Yeah. You know, this is a typical piece of sort of anger and fear from that period. This is Catherine MacKinnon, who was a feminist philosopher, who felt like the entire relationship between men and women was one of men exploiting and objectifying women. So, you know, there was that kind of feeling of great limitation at the same time, a great possibility. Well, I think that that's probably why the book was so popular. And by 1980, and that's the DSM-3, the green one on top. The DSM is the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. And that's what all mental health workers use when they see a patient and they put a diagnosis in the patient so they can get insurance reimbursement. The multiple personality disorder, because of a lot of politicking among people who were very interested in it, the small group of people who did a lot of political work around this, they got it into the DSM in 1980. And all of a sudden, the diagnosis skyrocketed. It had been a very rare diagnosis for the last 200 years. There'd maybe been less than 90 cases in 200 years in the whole world. Now, all of a sudden, there's thousands of cases. Women are coming into therapy with things like anorexia or overeating or depression or marital problems, and they're walking out with multiple personality disorder. And they're being told that they need to find out what happened to them. They can't remember because it's somewhere else in their mind. It's in the mind of another personality. But something terrible happened. Now we need to do all this stuff with the pentothal, the hypnosis, drugs. We have to get to the bottom of this. There are all kinds of books that start to come out. Probably some of you have heard of When Rabbit Howls. That was a big famous one. There was The Flock. That was another famous one. And these are memoirs by women who have far more personalities than 16. We start to have 80 personalities, 400 personalities. Some of the personalities are trees. Some of them are rocks, you know. And even Roseanne Barr thought that she had multiple personalities. This is her memoir, the one on the right. Well, everybody's in therapy, trying to figure out what happened to them. Drugged, hypnotized, pentothal. They start remembering something very odd. They start remembering that their parents were in satanic cults and that their parents were doing the most horrible things to them. I think you've already studied this, is that right? So I won't go into the details about what some of these motifs were in satanic ritual abuse. They involve cannibalism, you know, all kinds of stuff. So this is like a drawing that somebody might make under hypnosis or under pentothal about the satanic ritual they were victimized by when they were a child. And this is a book for women who go into therapy and are diagnosed and start to have these memories, and this will help them get new memories. Even Joan Baez got into this. She got on the bandwagon. Back in the 80s, she did an album called Play Me Backwards. And the signature song, Play Me Backwards, that's about like satanic, you know, playing records backwards for the secret messages. And that particular song, Play Me Backwards, is about satanic ritual abuse perpetrated against children by Mexicans, which I thought was very odd. I mean, Joan Baez is part Mexican, so perhaps she was blaming her father, but at the same time, it was a very anti-immigrant message for the late 80s. Well, it hit television. This is late 70s. Sally Jesse was always having multiple personality patients on talking about their satanic abuse by their parents. Oprah, Geraldo. So there's a complete, by the 1980s, there's a total panic about the Satanists abusing these people. Well, now they're all grown up. They got abused when they were little. They only remembered this while they were in therapy for multiple personality disorder. Well, where are the kids? If it happened back then, it must still be happening. Well, we start to get the daycare cases. Now, it's interesting because in the McMartin case, which was the longest and most expensive trial in United States history, started at a preschool in Southern California. There was an 80-year-old woman accused, her 63-year-old daughter, and her daughter, you know, and a son who was in his early 20s. It was an entire family that ran a very prestigious daycare center. That case went on for 8 years and finally ended with acquittals and a hung jury on the son. But the children in that case, and there were hundreds of them, were interviewed first by psychiatrists who had learned about satanic ritual abuse by treating multiple personality adults. So that's where the ideation came from. For satanic ritual abuse in daycare centers. It came from multiple personality theory. This is a woman, and you may remember this case, the Kelly Michaels case in New Jersey. This is Kelly Michaels. She was supposed to have had the kids lie down in star shapes, pentagram shapes, you know, and done ritualistic things to them. She was in prison for 5 years before her appeal was successful, which was based on a tremendous amount of research into children's suggestibility and into panic. There were even books for kids. This is a book that was in the library down where I used to live in Texas. Don't Make Me Go Back, Mommy, a child's book about satanic ritual abuse. So if your kid was in therapy and the therapist believed in this stuff, your kid could get this book, go through it with the therapist, and come out with these ideas, these memories. This kind of coverage was typical. There were actually cases in New York, but they were never publicized very much. There was a big one in the Bronx in the late 80s called the Praca case, if anybody remembers it. Well, finally, too many adult women in therapy were accusing their elderly parents of being Satanists and eating babies. And too many prisoners, as a matter of fact, if you look at that picture on the article on the right, there were these murderers, you know, and rapists who were using as their defense that they had multiple personalities. And one or two were acquitted early on using that defense, but pretty soon the DAs, everybody got pretty cynical about that. And this is interesting, the one on the right, jailed child molester admits faking multiple personalities. He was diagnosed by Connie Wilbur, by Sybil's therapist. And then he later on said, you know what, I just made it all up. So a lot of, by the late 90s, a lot of skepticism was developing about both of these phenomena, multiple personality and the daycare cases. You know, child abuse, junk science, people were realizing that all of these theories about children never lying, about dissociation of memories, about recovered memories, bad ideas about how to interview a child. You know, it sort of was becoming so common that it even entered the cartoon format, which is what this is. As you can see in this picture, this is about recovered memory suits. There's a big decline. You know, there's a huge rise in the early 90s and then a very swift decline. It was almost like a panic, like a fever that broke. And a lot of skepticism about multiple personality disorder. And yet, it still appears in the DSM, And the DSM will be revised in 2013, and it will be in there. There hasn't been any politicking around it. And it's still very much in the popular culture. This is a scene from United States of Tara. Did anybody see that? No? That was I think it was a HBO or, you know, a cable show with Toni Collette that won a lot of awards, and she plays a woman with three alters, and this was just very recently. So this is her gay son reading Sybil. And, you know, pretty much my interest in this has been in the harm that multiple personality caused in the criminal justice system and in the culture. The idea that women, you know, that women are so weak that we can't remember things that have happened to us, that we have to go back in order to sort of be well, in order to be whole, to feel whole. We have to blame someone. We have to go back and find things in our childhood, find a horrible victimization. I don't think that does women a lot of good. And at the same time, I find it really interesting that we're so fascinated by that idea. We're so drawn to that idea. And that's sort of what pushed me through 3 years of research and into the writing of Sybil Exposed. So I'd like to open it up for questions. There has been some challenge, and actually I don't think psychiatrists think of me as Satan. There is a small group of psychiatrists who definitely think of me as Satan. And they have enough contacts with people who are who have a long history with this diagnosis and who are very big in the committees, you know, people who are pretty prestigious in the committees. There are committees on dissociation. I mean, every diagnosis has a committee. And these committees were formed a long time ago, and some of the people that were invested in this diagnosis are still on the committees. And they are in touch with people who still practice this diagnosis. I mean, most psychiatrists and psychologists at this point don't diagnose multiple personality disorder, but there are enough of them that still do that it remains in the DSM, and it would take a movement to remove it. And I can't tell you why that hasn't happened. I have heard that my book has had some influence, that there's a lot of discussion now because of my book. No, actually, my feeling about this, if you're familiar with the DSM, is that there's a part of the DSM called culture-bound syndromes, and that's an attempt to deal with a lot of troubling behaviors on the part of immigrants to the United States. You know, dissociation, spacing out is what it is. We all dissociate, right, to one degree or another. You can be driving down the highway and it's the 200th time you've done it, and all of a sudden you realize that you don't remember. You don't even remember being on the highway. You just know you left your house and you got where you were going. That's called highway hypnosis. It's a form of dissociation. There are more intense forms of dissociation that some people get into, either because of anxiety or because it's part of the culture. Like if you've been to a fundamentalist Christian church and people go into, they get the gift, you know, like if people get the gift, right, and they start trembling and, you know, going like this or talking in tongues, those are dissociative experiences that people actually won't remember later on. But those are part of their culture, so they're not troubling to people. And there are diagnoses in the DSM from various cultures where, for example, there are certain cultures in Southeast Asia where men believe that their genitals are disappearing into their body. And they start having these terrible anxiety attacks and running around and they don't remember later. And so there are several of those diagnoses in the DSM. And I believe that this diagnosis is a culture-bound diagnosis. It's a diagnosis that was created by the culture at a certain period, and when women confront or when they're in a situation in the community or with therapists who want this behavior, they produce the behavior. And it's very troubling. I mean, it makes you sick. It's not faking. This is not like pretending. These are people who are dissociative, meaning that they space out, they go sort of into these hypnotic states, and if the dissociation is shaped by the expectation that you will have lots of personalities and that you will remember horrible trauma, then you will do that and you will get very sick. So I do think that it's a disturbing, troubling behavior, but I think it's in the wrong part of the DSM. Well, that's what's so complicated about it. I feel that it didn't do women a lot of good, but it was embraced by people. It was embraced by feminists. Yes. Gloria Steinem, for example, called it a gift. She called multiple personality a gift. She wanted it to be called MPG rather than MPD. The idea that you could have all of these selves in some way was thought to express strength. I mean, it wasn't just a reaction to the splitting of roles. It was also thought of as something really wonderful. So, I mean, it's a very complicated phenomenon, what happened culturally. Somebody had, yeah. It's too susceptible to junk science, because experts come in and they give testimony about theories that don't stand up to empirical research. That's what it says. It's about 9 to 1. Out of every 10 people diagnosed, 9 are women. People don't go to psychiatrists and psychologists because they're having a good time. I mean, they walk into the office of somebody because they've got a problem. And it's quite common that they're suffering from depression or they're suffering from anxiety. Now, there also are a lot of people who have been in the system for years. I think someone did a study and found that the average time that people have been in the mental health system going from doctor to doctor before they get this diagnosis is 6 or 7 years. And many of them have been diagnosed as borderline or schizophrenic, bipolar. One thing that always seemed interesting to me was that when you got this diagnosis back in the 80s and early 90s, you became like a princess. I mean, it's so exciting for the therapist to have a multiple. If a schizophrenics are treated like garbage, you know, this is like the lowest status diagnosis you could have. To have your diagnosis change from a low status diagnosis to a high status diagnosis must be really, I mean, wonderful, because all of a sudden you're getting attention. And I have a friend who's a psychologist and writer who believes that that was also part of the appeal, because, you know, you get treated well in a certain way, you get attended to, but the demand is that you have to produce a great sickness. You have to get sicker to get better attention. People are always speculating that they were gay, and actually I think that Shirley probably in this day and age would have come out as gay. I don't think Dr. Wilbur was. Everybody wants Dr. Wilbur to be gay. And I don't think that she was. I think that the relationship for her was more like she was not able to have children. In the 40s, to be a woman in your 30s and she was married, and not to have children was a pretty bad thing. And I think she wanted Shirley to be her daughter. She treated her like a daughter. But in order to do that, she had to depose Shirley's mother. And I think that's one of the big reasons why she laid this trip on Shirley of how terrible her mother was, because she wanted to be her mother. Well, I think that her ideas about pentothal, about how all you got to do to get somebody to remember is give them some pentothal, that came from the war. That was male psychiatrists. And the mother-hating stuff actually preceded her. There were many male psychiatrists, actually going back to people who thought they were revising Freud, who thought that mothers are the cause of all difficulties. I mean, if you look at every one of her theories, she didn't come up with those theories. She just applied them in this particular case. And the idea of trauma being the cause of multiple personality disorder precedes her. It actually goes back to the late 19th century. So.
Mm-hmm. How many personalities did she have?
16, which is nothing now, because there are people now who supposedly have 4,000. And does anybody remember The Three Faces of Eve?
Yes.
That was the first big Hollywood movie, and she only had three.
Right.
Yeah, so they've multiplied and multiplied and multiplied. No, I haven't heard anyone talk like that. What struck me as interesting about this was that it's the first time that sex is so explicit. I mean, this is really, you know, graphic rape and child rape. And actually, in the archives, the letters to the writer, there are all these teenage girls writing and saying, "I loved your book. What I liked the best was the rape scenes." This is from 13-year-olds. So, you know, there is that prurience that we have about sex. You know, we have, I mean, we have sexual fantasy, but this gave us permission to think about this stuff because it was real. And if we thought about it, we were helping things, right? We were being concerned about making things better. So it's sort of this prolet cult, you know. We can't fantasize. We can't admit that we have these prurient fantasies. It's okay if they're real. If this really happened, then it's okay to think and talk about it. And as a matter of fact, the book was serialized on the women's pages of many newspapers, like on the same page as The Recipes and Dear Abby. I mean, I don't think anything like that had ever happened before. I asked the Times, the New York Times, if I could go up there and spend a few weeks, because my sense is that the girls are saying something. They're using this hysteria, because that's what it is, to say something. I don't know what it is. There's something about the community that's troubled, and they're speaking for the community, you know, in some very unconscious way. But to get to that, you'd have to spend a long time up there. They sent somebody up there, and she only spent 3 days, so she didn't have a lot to say. No, and it's interesting, because there was supposed to be this destructive personality that would go into stores and smash things, the Peggy personality. She would smash glass. Well, one of the things the journalist was wondering, you know, for a while she believed everything, then she realized a lot of it wasn't true, but she went ahead with it. But one of the things she was puzzled by was, well, she kept going in stores and smashing things. Why didn't the cops come? Apparently, you know, she never did anything weird in front of anybody except for people who knew that she was a multiple. That was only two people, her therapist and her roommate, who was also being treated by the same therapist. Well, the behaviors are different now. You don't see too many people now with hysterical blindness or hysterical deafness or the inability to walk. What you see now is suicidal behavior. You see aggression. I mean, it's interesting how people enact trauma. You know, people enact trauma through their behavior in different ways, in different cultures, in different times in history. So people are enacting their troubles about what they experienced in the war now in a different way than they did then.